Andy, welcome always. Thank you for your gifts. Welcome all to worship at First Presbyterian Church of Palo Alto this August 2nd. Can you believe that it is already August? It feels like it's been 20 years since all of this pandemic started happening, but it's still starting to move so quickly. So I'm glad you're able to spend your time with us this morning. I have a few welcomes and announcement items before we get into worship. First, we just want to welcome you to this space, whether you're a longtime member or it is your first time, or you're a returning friend from who knows what state you are joining us from. We're glad that you've chosen to spend your morning with us. Lots of other things you could be doing, and so we're grateful that you're choosing to spend your Sunday with us this morning. A few announcements for the life of the church as we get going. There's so much going on. We're starting to really move into some new life and new beginnings and activities. Follow us on all of the electronic places, but sign up for our newsletter, which is really important to get so you can keep up with all of the things that are happening. But I do want to lift up a few. First is you have about another month that to connect. Not that I won't connect with people after the summer, but I've saved a bunch of spots on the calendar to connect with folks, and I'm grateful for the conversations I've had with many of you so far. Please feel free to go ahead and schedule a time to connect by either phone or Zoom. The link will be in the chat room. It's also in our weekly email. We started a Bible study the last 3 weeks of August on Thursday evenings at the 13th, 20th, and 27th. It'll be on Philemon. We may have another church joining. My mom's church from Hayward, they are interested in coming. So we may have some other folks joining us and would encourage you to come, and I'll do a little bit of introduction. We'll do some breakout groups and discussion, but a good time to look at Philemon, which is a book probably most folks have not read. So we're gonna jump into this very short book in scripture. And then we are still looking at trying to create some more pen pals. If you're feeling like you're isolated and you want to just connect with somebody, or if you need to connect with more people, we would love for you to let our care and compassion team know so that we can partner you with folks. And it's just a way to have some more connection during a pretty tough time for a lot of folks. So if you would like to sign up to connect with somebody, please let us know. There's a talent show this Friday, pretty exciting. That'll be this Friday. Andy is hosting that and is going to DJ and MC that with a bunch of folks from our community who will be sharing their gifts. So there, you have to register for that. Check the chat room as well as our, it's on the website and the newsletter. That's 7:30 this Friday. And then we have homecoming that will happen the second weekend of September. And we're going to create another video Brady Bunch thing. I'm sure that's not the technical word for it, but that's what we're going to do. Thanks to Andy and Karen Huddleston, who are helping to organize and edit and all of that. If you're interested in doing this, like me, I don't traditionally sing in the choir. I'm going to take a square. Would encourage other folks, if you've never done this, to go ahead and jump in. I'm going to trust that Karen, when I don't sound good, is just going to lower my volume. So we will all sound wonderful together. So let us know if you want to participate in that. And then this Saturday, would encourage you to come to our Futuring Town Hall. You can register for that. It'll probably go 10 to 11:30-ish. Time for us to recheck in as a church and to begin to think about where we are headed next and all the exciting things that could be happening for our congregation, which I'll talk about today during the sermon a bit. So encourage you to register and come to that for discussion and getting to know each other and have some voice in where we are headed. And lastly, we do have coffee hour breakouts after worship and encourage everybody to stick around for that. It's just about 15 minutes to check in, kind of like that casual time right after worship when we meet face to face, a chance to just connect with people. All right, a few Zoom reminders for those of you that are new, or just reminders for those of us that are here often. Sharing your video is optional. I know that that gets a little tiring sometimes, but you can go ahead and share. We do record this and post it on YouTube for about 20 or so folks who watch it afterwards. And then use the chat room. This is a place where you're invited and encouraged to go ahead and talk through worship, basically. Ask questions, lift up prayers, share the love. We will ask you to unmute yourselves, and we keep everybody muted just to make sure that we keep this space as safe as possible. And at 10:30, we actually close the service down. So if you're ever trying to get in, you got to get in before 10:30, and that's when we no longer let any new folks in. And then, as I always say in life and on Zoom, this will not be perfect. It never is. Doesn't have to be. But excited about having you all here today. Our service today, pretty simple. We do some singing and some prayer, confession, read a scripture. I'll do a brief reflection and sermon. We do an offering. Today, we're going to do polling. The first Sunday of the month, we're going to try some polling. So I have some questions for you to think about and to answer during that offering time. And then we have special music. Matt Black is joining us from Chicago, who's going to be leading our music and sharing music with us today. And then we have communion. So make sure you get something to eat and drink for communion. And then we'll have our charge, benediction, and coffee time. All right. Whew, all the intros are out of the way. We begin our time every Sunday with some centering. 3 minutes seems like a long time, and it feels excruciatingly long sometimes, but very few moments in our week do we just sit in silence. And so I ring a chime and then invite you to just listen for your breath, to center yourselves. Also, as a time for us to remember the land upon each of us are now sitting or standing or lounging, that it was not ours and was taken. And so we remember our Native American siblings and their land, and for remembering and lamenting that we now sit on it. So let's take some time for centering, remembering, and then we'll join in prayer with Jeff.
Oh God, our rock and our salvation. We live in times of uncertainty and upheaval, the likes of which few of us have seen or experienced before. We come to you this day, this hour, knowing that though we walk through this valley of many shadows and fears, we will fear no evil, for you are with us. You have walked this valley before, and you are walking this valley with us now. We know that many of us are living in relative comfort, while many more are risking their lives in the service of others. We pray for their safety and for the safety of all. Many others are risking their lives to awaken our country to the fierce urgency of now, the urgency to turn away from racism and injustice and to embrace all your children as the beloved community you have called us to be. Open the hearts and minds of people everywhere, that we may heed your call for love and justice to reign through every neighborhood and community, through the cities and counties and states, till justice rolls down like a river and righteousness like an everlasting stream. In the name of Jesus, our brother, amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Matt, for sharing your music with us today. We join now in our confession. And for those of you that are new to our tradition, this is the time where we come into the space and we recognize that we're not perfect and we need to confess that which holds us back from connecting with God. We also understand that it's individual and it's corporate and communal, and that if any of us holds on to any of our sins, we all hold on to them. Today, Edie joins us. And the way this works is that you'll join Edie on the one phrase and then you'll join me. Edie will say the one phrase and you'll join me on the many. Again, you're all muted, so you're saying this in your space. So let's join in our prayer of confession.
Too often we hunger for food that does not nourish and water that does not quench.
God of mercy, forgive us when we are fooled by the false promises of the world.
Too often we experience the grace and love that you provide and we keep it to ourselves.
God of abundance, forgive us when we live as if your love is ours to hoard.
God, each day you give us courage to both give and receive your love and your grace.
With each breath, we are renewed and given courage to know, believe, and share. Let's now take a few moments for silent personal confession. And now receive and offer the peace that Christ offers us.
Peace be with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with our neighbors, our friends, and our families.
And also with you.
Peace be with the strangers, enemies, those who are feared, and those who are afraid.
And also with you.
Peace be with all the world and all of God's beloved.
And also with you. Sisters, brothers, siblings in Christ, hear the good news that in the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and made new.
Let us be at peace with ourselves and with all we meet.
Amen. Now is the time where we open it up and you'll see each other's faces for the first time. So you can go ahead and make sure you're on gallery view, share your video if you would like. We'll just scroll through, wave, say hello. It is chaotic and lovely. I'll stop sharing the screen now. We can all say hello and pass a peace and then we'll come back and hear scripture. Here we go.
Hello, peace.
Nope. I just switched you all.
Good to see you.
Hi, everybody.
Good to see everyone.
Hi, peace be with you.
Peace. Good morning.
Peace.
Good morning.
Good
morning.
Morning. Faces
and names.
Morning, Cheryl.
Morning, Diane. Oh, yeah, there's Bill. Hi, Bill.
Hi, Mom.
There's morning, Mom. Francis.
Morning, Edie. Show us the ocean.
Hi, Diane.
Edie has a real background of an ocean this morning. Yes, that's right.
Let's see.
Wonderful.
Let me see it.
There you go.
Yeah.
Morning, Mitzi. Oh, yeah.
Hi, Cindy.
All right. Good to see you all. All right, I'm going to go ahead and we're going to go back and Edie will go ahead and share scripture with us.
All of you who are thirsty, come to the water. Whoever has no money, come. Buy food and eat. Without money, at no cost, buy wine and milk. Why spend money for what isn't food and your earnings for what doesn't satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good. Enjoy the richest of feasts. Listen and come to me. Listen and you will live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you. My faithful loyalty to David. Look, I made him a witness to the peoples, a prince and commander of peoples. Look, you will call a nation you don't know. A nation you don't know will run to you because of the Holy One, your God, the Holy One of Israel, who has glorified you. The Word of God.
All right. As we begin, we're going to do something a little different. I'm going to try to do some discussion time as part of today's thing. We'll see how this works and how we can do that. But I'll say a few words first before we begin. So let us first begin with a word of prayer. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, for just the ability to gather, for the wonder and imagination of technology, for the ways in which we have stretched ourselves to be in this space, for the ways in which we continue to yearn for community, we give you thanks. We ask that your spirit would guide the words of my mouth, the meditations of all of our hearts. Continue to uplift our souls and our spirits, giving us courage and hope and peace in the midst of a time that is so overwhelming and disruptive. We thank you for an opportunity to gather this day, and may that spirit continue to move us into the world. We pray all this in the name of Christ, and God's people say, amen. So the passage that we have today is kind of it's an interesting one. It is taking place in the midst of exile, where folks are struggling, figuring out what is going on, all that. And so God comes into this space and basically is saying, hey, all of you are thirsty. If you are searching for something, I'm offering this to you now. And it's really a, hey, if you're looking, if you're seeking, if you're struggling, whatever that may be, here I am. Here is what I offer to you. You don't have to have anything. I'm just offering you this, in some ways, relief, care, nurture during this time of exile where you are struggling and trying to figure out what is going on, during this time where you don't know what the future holds, during this time where you're questioning, I am here. And whenever I think this passage itself, one of the commentaries I read, it said it's an attention all shoppers thing, where it's just God says out to the world, I'm here. If you're looking, we're right here. And while it would be an easy way to go through this, is like, look at all the good stuff we have. But I think the context in which the Babylonians are experiencing this is struggle. And so I think about that in terms of, it's one thing to be a church or a community that just says, come get the goodness. It's so good here. Oh my gosh, we're amazing. You're just going to feel good. If you come here, you will prosper. This gospel of prosperity, all these things. But the reality is God offers this to a people who are struggling, who were seeking all kinds of things, who are trying to figure out, how do I hold on to something that is secure and comforting and calm in the midst of so much that is wrong and disruptive and difficult and overwhelming and all of those things that are happening. And the connection to our world today is not hard to make. We too are trying to figure out, what do we do in a world that seems so overwhelming? We don't want to be part of a community that just completely says, it's going to be okay, don't worry about it, rah, rah, rah. We want to be in a community that acknowledges the pains of the world. We don't stay there, but we acknowledge that there are things that we're struggling with that our faith is trying to answer and address. That we're saying, God is saying to us, those of us that have been drawn to the church and community, you are struggling, but here, come. We will try to figure this out together. I have the spirit that will help you move. But I think it's very easy for us to look around and see what doesn't satisfy as we reach out for the kinds of things that may give us a sense of comfort and stability in times of chaos and change. We look at the environment around us and the Pacific garbage patch and things like this. Whenever I see images of this underwater or above, National Geographic has some amazing, powerful images, we realize that the ways in which we use our resources in the world, while they may satisfy us in a moment, they create pain in other places. We still know that while our congregation and many are open and affirming to LGBTQIA+ folks, that there is still transphobia and homophobia and violence perpetrated upon our LGBTQIA brothers and sisters and siblings. that we know folks are struggling. That while we may seek and know some affirming spaces, that our world in itself is not everyone feels satisfied, and that there is still pain and struggle. We know that when it comes to systematic racism, we continue to be reminded, as we should be, about how big of a movement George Floyd created, but then how difficult the long-term work is going to be. So we continue to remember and be reminded and sometimes get tired, but we have to keep staying in this because what holds power, we know, does not satisfy. We have just been seeing more and more government authorities acting with impunity. This is a picture from Friday night when No More Deaths was raided by the Border Patrol. No More Deaths is an organization that many of us have supported in the past, who go out and provide food and shelter and first aid to those who are in the desert seeking asylum or refugees, saving lives. And they were, 30 people were arrested. Their camp was overrun. That in a way to try to act, it provides some stability for a certain particular part of our world and our country. We know that this is not satisfying. And we know that in our current time, that this moment when many of us are taking seriously this call to remain separate, to shelter in place, to not step into situations where we may contribute to the spread of the virus, that it is taking a toll on us. That it doesn't satisfy because we are experiencing isolation, sickness, death during these times. There's so much to look at in the world and see what is not satisfying, that does not feed us, does not nourish us, does not give us a sense that God is with us or present or calling or healing or loving, all those things. We can easily begin to say God is not saying, all who are thirsty and hungry, come. And so, and I think it is our job to begin as people of faith to claim those spaces, though, where God does say that through the work of our congregation and others, to say that what God is saying to those who are struggling and in exile and yearning for something to alleviate the pain, that we believe that God does offer that. It is not a booming voice from the sky. It is not sent via a text or an email, but it is about who we are as God's people called into that space on behalf of God. I think about why we want to do this. And part of it is bringing good news in times of struggle, the dreaded evangelism word. Now, some of you like it, some of you don't. I love the idea that we are in a time of struggle. And the good news, so evangelios, and it comes out of really giving good news after battle, like you've won this huge battle. And I don't, you know, look like the military imagery, but at the same time, we are in a struggle, and it is time, if not now, when, to really claim our space in healing and acknowledging that we have a space and a place and a calling into the healing of so much pain. Popularity points, if you know what this movie is from, you can put it in this image, you can put it in the chat room, one of my favorite movies ever, one of the best movies ever made, but I won't stay there. We do have choices to make, right? We are confronting things left and right in the world, and we have to decide if we are going to be about stepping into that space, even more so than we have, to share a message of good news that is founded by God in a way that we haven't done before or have been reluctant to do before. Because I think what is needed in many ways is a different version of the gospel. So many folks are claiming space in our culture, in our politics, in our world that does destruction to who I believe God is calling us to be. And so it's not as if we're competing. We're not trying to rack up numbers. What we are saying is there is good news in this struggle, and what others might be claiming as God's good news is not what we believe it is. And so if not now, to really step into that space, when are we gonna do it? every time I see somebody on TV or on the radio or on Twitter or somewhere in social media claiming the church thinks this, or as a Christian, I believe this, or these people are not faithful, or this movement or organization doesn't believe in this, or any of those kinds of ways that we are allowing certain voices to hold on to the voice of Christianity and the message we are trying to send, we have some choices here. We know it's happening, and we can either step into that space and speak a different word, or we can abdicate that space to a version of the gospel that will only hurt and harm. And so for me, I have to look at what does that mean for us? And I'm going to ask you a couple questions in a minute. We'll try to see if this will work in a discussion based on Zoom. But this goes hand in hand with this idea that we are called to be in the world and to go and make disciples, baptizing them. And you've heard this passage over and over again. It may give some of you the willies and the cringies because you've heard it in a way that is about conquering and victory and salvation, that our job is to go out and make every single person that we know. In fact, we are supposed to go and intentionally be out there baptizing in the name, and normally you hear it in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, that's our job, that it is this great commandment, go and do this. Well, actually, many translations, if you were to look at the Greek and look at go, it's not a command. It's not actually a, everybody, you have to go. Philip Wickery was a mentor of mine in seminary, and his translation of this was, as you go, make disciples. Not everybody go, and it's this great command that everybody has to do it, but it's as you go. And for me, that makes so much more sense. My understanding of who God calls me to be in the world isn't one from the ilk of our Christian space where my job is to go out and save people. That's not who I believe we are supposed to be. But that as we live our lives and as we are in the world, we do share why we are there, why we are in this space. It's not simply because we think it's a good idea or we're feeling compassion, empathetic. It's because God has called us to be in these spaces. And as we go, we share why we are there. Now, again, this is a difficult thing for some, not for others, but it is part of our tradition where Christ calls us to be out in the world and to go out and share the good news, to share what God has called us to. Jesus goes out all the time and says, go, speak to folks. And it's easy for us to just not do that because it's uncomfortable and awkward. But at these days, we have no excuse because so much is happening that we need to be out in more ways and in different ways than we've ever been before. I say this because I think people are yearning for the divine. They're yearning for that which is not satisfying in the world. Folks see the destruction and the pain around them and are yearning for some understanding of why. I also think that in the healing of others, when we step into that space, we too are healed. If we believe that if one part of the body is suffering, we're all suffering, we need to be in those spaces so the suffering of others can be healed and thus the whole body is healed. And that we are called as we go to make disciples, that we are called to step into spaces and say, this is why we do what we do. We would love to invite you into this space to continue to struggle and explore what it means to follow the way of Jesus. I think about people like the Reverend Dr. Liz Theo Harris. Those of you that listened to our webinar or have heard her before, it's amazing, right? Person of faith, brilliant, and goes out and is speaking about a moral space in our country that is based on scripture, faith. It's inner faith, but her particular place is about a calling by Christ into the world as she goes. I think about folks like Reverend Denise Anderson. She preached for us a few months ago that her calling for us to see humanity and what it means for us to meet people in their pain and their struggle to find transformation and healing and love,
especially in these spaces where we're talking about race and anti-racism. What does it mean for us as people of faith? Denise brings her faith into all of those conversations to heal and be healed. As she goes, she makes disciples. For those of you that watched John Lewis's funeral this past week, the Reverend James Lawson, Reverend in the United Methodist Church, he shares who he is around nonviolence. If you, any of you did not hear him, this man is 91 years old and brought us to church in a way that was amazing. If you haven't seen it, I would encourage you to watch it. But he is talking about nonviolence and the challenge to be in those spaces where folks are seeking the divine, you're healing the justice, and that we too are healed. And as he goes, he makes disciples. And my favorite Presbyterian, the Reverend Dr. Fred Rogers, Mr. Rogers, if no one else saw that folks were yearning for some connection to something greater, the healing of others in that we were also healed, and that as he went, he made disciples. Now, none of these people are perfect. None of them hold perfection in their faith. Positions and opinions have changed for all of them. But what they carry for us and challenge for us is that we bring our faith into these spaces in ways that provide healing and hope for others. So that we can't be a church. We can't be a church of osmosis. I grew up in a church sometimes that it felt like maybe we didn't talk about things enough and we just kind of understood this is the way things were. But I think most of our churches, we need to step into these spaces even more. That we have to remind people about why we are here. What do we offer? What healing can we offer? That is in many ways more sustaining than what maybe people are choosing. So the question I have for you today and would invite you to engage in this in the chat room is, why are you even here? What is that? Why are you in this space? What draws you in to the space that we exist now as this church? What do you think we offer? What do you think we offer as a congregation to the world? And the question I want to ask you in a minute for you to share as we bounce around a little bit is, what's hindering our ability or willingness to make disciples? I will say that I came to this church over a year ago, not only because I believed in where you were theologically and ideologically, not only because of the hospitality and welcome, not only because it was a chance to be in a pulpit and in a congregation for my last call of a career, but it was because I feel like what we are and what we offer to the world is needed and yearned for. And that there is, despite what many folks say about the future of the church, that we have possibility, that we have the potential, we have the ability, the theological grounding and commitment to justice and spirituality to reach folks like they have not been reached before. But for whatever reason, those folks have not been coming in. We have not, in your history, have seen growth in the last 10 years or so, even more. And so I think it is not because of who we are and what we believe. I think the challenge is for us, how do we share that in a different way? How do we tell our story in a way that folks hear and respond and answer the calling? So I want to ask you this quick question. What is hindering our ability or willingness to make disciples? And I'm going to stop sharing. And like we would do when we're in person, I am going to just go ahead and invite you to, if you have a response to that very short, brief, go ahead and unmute yourself. This is dangerous. Go ahead and unmute yourself and go ahead and share. I'm not going to try to call on people. There are too many screens. But why do you think we may be reluctant to share what we offer with the world? Somebody go for it. Come on, I know you're not shy.
We don't understand marketing and outreach.
Marketing and outreach, just the very telling of the story. Thank you. All right, anyone else?
Afraid of conflict.
Afraid of conflict. Flesh that out a little more. What do you mean by that?
Well, it's a very delicate thing to start talking about what you believe because somebody else believes something different. Mm-hmm. And then you're into a real conversation where you have to have the right skills, I think, to have it come out peaceful.
Right. Thank you, Tom. Thank you. I mean, in some ways, though, I think in our culture, we assume there's going to be conflict. But I will tell you, as a pastor, when I go out in the world, very few people have argued with me about my faith. They're actually very interested. When people ask me what I do, I have some pastor friends that they like, oh, I help lead a nonprofit. And I'm like, come on. Like, such great opportunities to say, oh, I pastor a church. And yeah, I've been a Presbyterian minister. And folks are fascinated by, like, it's often like, really? And then they try to see if they've cussed in front of me. That's usually what happens. Like, they're always worried that they say bad words in front of the minister for some reason. But then I've never had an interaction that folks have judged right away and assumed that I was bad. I think one of the things we have to do is shift our expectations, right? If it comes up naturally, it's different than you walking into work and saying, hey, know what I did on Sunday? You know, that's different than as you're talking with someone to begin to share about why you believe what you do. All right, anybody else? Kathy, I see you're unmuted. Do you want to share?
I was just going to quickly say, your experience is probably a sign that you're going about it the correct way. Whereas you could go to people and say, hey, you need to be a Christian. Let me tell you why. But if you just start with, I'm a Christian, here's why, I'm just going to leave that open and I've shared my experience, then it usually goes
well. Yeah. Yeah. Certainly. We all know there are bad ways to do it, right? We all have seen, and I am very fortunate. I did not come out of any kind of conservative evangelical spaces. And I know many of you did, and that there is a lot that is tied up. And my friends and colleagues who are having to strip away that kind of toxic Christianity that is part of their cell memory. I'm grateful that that's not what I grew up in. That, you know, Trinity, where I grew up, that was not kind of our perspective. It was more about, let's be out in the world in the community, serve one another, love one another, that kind of thing. And so I know that there are bad ways to do it, but I think most of you all, right, your natural way is not going to be sandwich boards and, you know, screaming into space. You're going to do it in a way that understands and honors relationship. All right. I mean, I think that's, I would assume how most of you would share about your faith. All right. Others, why are we reluctant?
Or sometimes I like to say I'm an introvert. So for me to go out and be out there kind of goes against my nature. I just want to be inside and I want to be writing. And sometimes I just don't want to cultivate that kind of conversation. But I will say I'm here because I get acceptance and I get to learn so much. And I feel like that this church gives me an opportunity to seek change in the world, where I think a lot of churches are about a personal relationship with God that has nothing to do with actually doing any kind of good work.
So I have found, thank you. I mean,
I'll do an opposite to the answer to the question of why it's hard. I'll talk about why it's easy for me. You know, I work in a bookstore, and so people have conversations. It's kind of like working in a bar, like you're the bartender. And when the topic of the conversation in some way touches on something that we do with the church or that our church does, I'll say, well, you know, the hunger thing that you were just talking about, well, we have this program where we do this. Or, you know, if they're talking about getting married, I say, oh yeah, my husband and I were married 30 years ago in our church. I'll find a way to talk about things that our church does. And I've never gotten a negative response. More often than not, it's, oh, what church is that? And then I tell them. So that's my way of dealing with it.
Yeah. I would say, thank you. I would say that that's exactly what's happened in my life, is that I say, I'm talking about some cause and action. I'll say, well, I do such and such of that through my church, just like Craig is saying. And it comes up naturally. This evangelism was something that my father and my mother practiced in very different ways. My father wanted to, he would go out there. In fact, he quit his regular job so he could go out and witness for Christ and try to bring people to Christ. While my mother always said, I will be a good example of the believer.
Well, and I think,
you know, here in the East Bay, which is seems to be the national capital of proud atheism, people are constantly scheduling meetings on Sunday morning. And I always speak up and say, I'm not going to go to a meeting on Sunday morning. I'm going to go to church. And I have people come to me and say, are you a Christian? And I go, shit, Jesus was a community organizer. What do you think we're doing here? I mean, it's really, there is an incredulity, and I think it's worse in the East Bay than it ever was when I lived in the peninsula, but it's really weird territory where the assumption is that, yeah, you can go to a political meeting on Sunday morning, nothing else to do.
Yep. No, I think you're absolutely right. I mean, I think part of this, what's happened in a world that wants to be so binary is you are either one who goes out and you're like, you choose, I'm going to be the one that goes out and speaks on the corner and is bringing people to Christ, or I'm just going to live by example and I don't have to say anything. And I think part of our struggle is that's that choice between a personal relationship and a communal relationship. You know, Cindy, you lifted that up, Evan, you lifted that up, that I think that our job is to find that middle ground that is much more difficult to sit in, right? That's what I think we offer an ability, because I think folks are trying and searching for stability. What we have told them as a church is you find stability by these answers or these answers. And I actually think we find stability by sitting in those questions, sitting in that murky middle and engaging with one another in a way that is often difficult, but we find peace and calm in the middle of that, not having to always know. And I know we say that, but I don't think we always live that to its fullest extent. All right, you all, this has been great. We may try this again. Thank you all for participating. You know, I think this is, for me, one of the reasons that your search committee called me to be here was not just to love you as a congregation and not just to help us think through who we are, but what does it mean for us to be a church into the future? Not because we want to survive, because we have a message and a gospel that we think is important and needed in the world. That's what excites me about being with you all and about the future of who we're going to be. But that has to be all of us. And so we begin this journey, we begin thinking about what does it mean for us to be the church, to grow the church, to continue to be a presence in the world in a way that you have been for generations and hopefully will continue to be into the future. All right, let's pray. And then Matt will lead us in another hymn. Let us pray. God, for your grace and for your presence in the world, we give you thanks for the calling that you have called us to. And sometimes the difficulty it is to speak our faith into spaces that we may not be used to or that we know may be conflicted. Give us the courage and the hope and the conviction to know that our faith, it is grounded in you, and it is real, and it is loving, and it is healing, and that most folks are seeking love and healing and genuine relationship. We thank you for the gift that you offer us, and we hope that we will continue to live that in the world that is in need of so much healing, a world in which we and all of us need to be healed together. We pray all this in the name of Christ, and all God's people say, amen.
So let me give this song a brief introduction, because this comes from the United Kingdom and the white evangelical Christian movement that often embodies the kind of toxic Christianity Bruce was referring to. But this song does fit the scripture really well, and it's a beautiful song. But I'm feeling, especially in that conversation, my thought is I live in tension with a musical style that is associated with toxic Christianity, even when the song itself is fine. So that's the baggage I'm bringing this morning. But let's sing this song. It fits the scripture beautifully, and the longing for something real that we've been talking about this morning. mountain. Dip your heart in the stream of life. Let your pain and your sorrow be washed away in the waves of God's mercy as deep cries out. We sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Holy Spirit, come. All who are thirsty, all who are weak, come to the fountain, dip your heart in the stream of life, let your pain and your sorrow be washed away in the waves of God's mercy. As deep cries out to deep, we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Matt, for bringing your music gift to us today. Some of you saw me. I forgot I'm on video and I'm playing air drums in the background. So if you saw that, that was just me playing air drums. All right. So we're going to do a little shifting today. We were going to do some polling today, but we're going to go ahead and skip that today. And then Matt's going to share another song with us in a minute. And then we will have our prayers of the people. And for those of you that are new with us during our prayers of the people, we ask that you raise your hand as you do, use in your participants list, or use *9 if you're calling in, and that will raise your hand. Alex will call on you and unmute you, and you can just share that prayer, and then I will make sure to kind of call on folks to pray for that during the week. And then we'd invite you to lift up prayers in the chat room as always, and then we'll go and say the prayer of Jesus and then have communion. So Matt, you're gonna go ahead and share special music now. I'm gonna go ahead and get out of this, and we'll just have you share music. So we stop sharing and spotlight you, sir. And there you go.
Great. It's been a long time coming. Can't understand. There's a light in the darkness, but we fall apart like we're building on sand. This love changes everything. It's a backbreaking job. You can't be king while you wait for the spring of the kingdom of God. It's a long time coming. We're a long way from home. We cry out for peace and the captives release, but we're singing alone. And every small step we take to become awake is the beauty that changes the world. And those who we called profane now have been called by name, and we're conquered by one little word. We've got stones in our hands. He just writes in the sand and says, didn't you hear what I said? God's in your neighbor's eye. God is close and inside. There's a new life ahead. It's been a long time coming. There's a long way to go. We follow a path and it doesn't come fast, so we're taking it slow. We are dreamers of history. We are lovers of. There's a spirit that guides us and keeps us alive when the going gets rough. It's a long time coming, but it's coming for sure. And maybe today might just be the first day of the year of the Lord.
Amen, Matt. Thank you so much. That was amazing. I'll be sure, folks, to share out Matt's information on our follow-up email this week about worship. So thank you, Matt. All right. Make sure you switch yourself back to gallery view so you can see everybody. And we'll now move to our prayers of the people time. We skipped over the offering piece just because we're going a little long today. But if you do want to help support what we're doing, we can put in the chat room a way to give online. Those of you who are still sending in checks, we appreciate you supporting what we are continuing to do as a community and a congregation here. But let's now move to our prayers of the people. And so use your participants, that your hand in there to raise your hand. I know there's quite a few prayers today, so we wanna go ahead and lift up those prayers. Before we start, I'll lift up just one. We are continuing to pray as a community for Anita Scott, who is still recovering from wrist, breaking her elbow and wrist and all kinds of stuff going on. We wanna make sure that we're continuing to pray for Anita and Scotty in all that they are dealing with these days. So other prayers that we wanna lift up today from the community. Go ahead and, Alex, you're up, go for it, ask.
Yeah, we can start with Derek and Craig, whose hand I saw.
Friends, we wanna give great thanks for the life, love, and music of First Presbyterian's former choir director and organist, Jim Bisbing. He passed away recently after a fall. His husband, Alan, has moved over to Oakland and is living with his mom and siblings. Prayers for Alan and all of Jim's family and all of those who loved, laughed with, sang with, and just enjoyed the wonderful life that Jim lived.
Great. Thank you all for Jim Bisbing. And for those of you, many of you knew him, as I'm hearing people reflect on this. So he obviously had a huge presence here. So, and for Alan and his family is there working at this point, there's no plans for a memorial. But you can get in touch with Derek and Craig if you haven't seen some of the notes floating around all of the First Press emails. So will somebody pray for the memory celebration of life, but also for Alan and his family as they mourn his grief. Great. Thank you. All right. Next.
Jim Silver, you can go ahead.
We just wanted to say a prayer of thanksgiving. We have a new member of our family, a new dog. And we're really excited. We picked him up yesterday, and he's getting used to the fact that he's now our dog, and we're very excited to have him. So
you can't make that announcement and then not show us.
Okay.
Oh, new Sheltie. Oh, very sweet, very sweet. Well, all right. So blessings on that for the Silver family. So for those of you that have pets, dogs, cats, birds, whatever you may have, you know that sometimes they provide us so much. Like my dog sits on my lap and my blood pressure just goes down. So for pets and what they provide for us, let's special prayers this day for our pets and for the Silvers. Great. Thank you. All right. Next.
Cheryl?
Yes, this coming week, my school district we're starting with students on Monday, but it's distance learning. And we are so thankful that they're giving us the opportunity to either work from home or work at school. So just prayers for the teachers and the staff, and especially the students and the parents. As we go through all of this uncertainty and how to provide good education for our students.
Great. Thank you, Cheryl, for Stockton Unified, for all the schools that are still making decisions, preparing, and for all of the struggle and conflict that is occurring out of all of this. We want to lift up primarily the students, that they are attended to and cared for in ways that make sense. Teachers, administrators, and decision makers. Will somebody make sure to pray for our students, teachers, everybody involved? Thank you. All right, next.
Don Rickford.
Yes, I'd like two prayers. One is for my cousin, Alan, who had quadruple bypass surgery yesterday, and actually the day before, and is recovering so well so far. And I'd like another prayer too for Ailish. She is actually the cousin of Paige, who we were praying for a long time. She's 10 years old and she had a perforated appendix. So she had emergency surgery to repair her perforated appendix. And she just came home from the hospital today. So prayers for her and for Alan.
Great, thank you. So will somebody pray for Alan, who's recovering from quadruple bypass surgery and sounds like is recovering well, and for Eilish, who had a perforated appendix, 10 years old, can't imagine at that age. Will somebody pray for Alan and Eilish, please? Thank you. All right, next.
Dave Thornton.
I just want to lift up a prayer of gratitude and thanksgiving, particularly today for Joyce Slizer, who has given such extraordinary leadership over many, many years, but this past month, leading us through the Hotel to Zinc process, and for all the people who contributed to that by doing meals and being hosts. And it was another successful month, but special thanks to Joy this morning.
Amen. Amen. I don't know if Joy's on here right now, but you can see the fingers waving for you and clapping for you, Joy. Yes, for Joy and her ongoing work with Hotel to Zinc, but this year it obviously created a many more complications, and for her commitment and just her passion and love for this program, and for the folks who are impacted by churches opening up their spaces during this time, we continue to lift up prayers. So for Joy, Hotel to Zinc, we want to lift up prayer. Will somebody pray for Joy in particular and Hotel to Zinc this week? Great, thank you. All right, others.
Scrolling through, but I don't see anything.
Remember, you can flail your hands about too if you'd like to be acknowledged, and we can't see your blue raised hand. No? All right. All right. Well, I will close with a word of prayer, and then we will say the Lord's Prayer and then end with communion. So let us pray. holy and amazing God, for the spirit that is in the space, the spirit that opens us up and reminds us that you are with us always, for the spirit that compels us into the world, even when we may not want to go. It compels us to be in spaces to provide healing and comfort with our presence, with our words, and with our actions. For each prayer lifted up today, for the myriad of ways in which the world is hurting, our friends, our community may need healing, and for just society and our culture in need of a common seeking for the common good. We ask, O God, that your spirit of justice and love will sweep over all of us so that we may experience the healing of the body. We thank you for the calling to which we have been called, to call and as we go to make disciples, the calling that Christ offers us, the very same Christ who called us to pray, our Creator in heaven, holy be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Now we come to time as we close our service where we share communion. We go out feasting and nourished. And so we know that as Christ came to the table with his friends and his community, the table that we sit at now is expanded beyond our imagination. And so we gather in this space with whatever is in our kitchen, whatever we have brought to eat and to drink, to share with the Spirit and to share with one another, to bring a sustenance of body, mind, and spirit. When Jesus was at the table, he was with his disciples. He took the bread. And so whatever bread or food, Pop-Tart or pancake you may be having today, I invite you to lift it up. And after he gave thanks to God, he broke it. And he gave it to them. And he said, take, eat. This is my body broken for you. Every time that you do this in remembrance of me.
And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup and said, this cup is a new covenant with God, made possible by my life poured out for you. Every time you drink it, remember me. Take and eat, for the feast is prepared and all are invited. The gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. Holy One, we are grateful for the gifts of love and community this day, even as we celebrate the sacred mysteries of our faith. Enrich our lives through these gifts, that we may be a blessing to one another and to the world, that we may share the bounty of your love and grace, justice and peace with all the world. In the name of all that is holy, amen.
Amen. Again, we'll do some coffee hour time after this for a few moments. Invite everybody to stick around for that, just to check in with one another, see some faces, just to connect. Your charge of benediction are this: to go forth into the world with compassion and justice in your hearts, to give voice to the silent and strength to the weak, to hear one another, see one another, care for one another, and love one another. It's all that easy, and it's all that hard. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the power of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. And all God's people say, amen. All right, all. If you have to go, hope you have a blessed week. But we'd invite all of you to stick around. I'm going to break you into small groups, and we'll do that for about 15 minutes or so, just to share a little bit. So.